after our technical issues, we're gonna start with Mikhail. He's gonna speak us about the high availability clusters in Neo4j. So thank you for coming.
Thanks. Cool. So thanks for having me. So I'm really happy that the room is so full, and despite the many rooms out there. So I wanted to focus on the new stuff in Neo4j's high availability cluster. So if you have any questions regarding the general approach in Neo4j clustering and so on in detail, then just do it after the talk, right? So Neo4j's cluster right now is in Neo4j Enterprise, and we have a master-slave replication setup, like in MySQL. And what it's used for is read scaling. So if you have applications with high throughput requirements, then you can scale your reads across a cluster of slave machines. And it also supports, in this regard, cache sharding, so that if you have sticky routing to the client, to the slaves, then your queries will hit the same hot data set, and so won't be there won't be a need to read the data from this, so it will be really fast. And fault tolerance, of course, to have failover. When we have master-slave setups in Neo4j, we don't have the traditional asset guarantees, because with the network you get automatic cap. So we go for eventual consistency by either writing to the master and the master pushes to the slaves, or by the slaves pulling from the master. That's configurable. So you can have the master within the transaction that you write push to a number of slaves, but not being able to push won't fail the transaction, so it will still succeed. And there's also the option that the slaves just pull them from the master asynchronously, depends on your requirements and your setup. It's also possible to write to slaves for kind of real consistency. Then the slave will grab a cluster global lock with the master, and they will only commit together in a two-phase commit operation. So when you write to slaves, then it will be super safe, but also much slower than the other way around. So that's the general Neo4j HA cluster setup. So if you have any detailed questions about that, then please ask later. In general, we have three different concerns. So first is cluster management. It's about members joining the cluster, leaving the cluster, health check, and so on, heartbeats. Then, of course, the important part of failover, what happens if some process of machine dies, especially if the master dies. You need a new master, so you have to find a way of consistently elect a new master based on some information that you gathered on the existing cluster. So, for instance, which was the last, or which is the node or the member with the most up-to-date graph state. And the important thing is that both the election process and also the distribution of the result have to be done in a very in a consistent manner, and also despite network failures and message losses and so on, which brings us to Paxos later on. And then, of course, there's the replication part that I said, which is keeping or making sure that the graph state that you change in one of the cluster members will propagate either directly or eventually to the other cluster members as well. So this contains things like ID generation that has to be globally. Then, of course, distributed logs. So if I log a graph element like a node or relationship on one node, then all the other nodes also must not write onto this element. And the pulling and pushing of transaction results that work in Neo4j, similar to the transaction logs that we write to this. So we use the kind of same transaction command structure for sending updates across the wire, but just using a different transport. In this case, it's NETI that's used. And of course, if you start up a new, or if you start up a machine which will probably join the cluster as a slave, it will very probably don't have the latest state of the cluster. So it will either incrementally pull the updates from the current master. So it tries to find the last transaction ID that's in both stores, and then pulls the delta updates. Or either if the store is too old, so if there are not enough log files or not enough incremental information available, or if it has no store, then it does a full store copy from the master, because it's still master-slave replication and no sharding. So we had a problem in pre-1.9, and that was zookeeper. Why was zookeeper a problem? Because everyone uses zookeeper, is happy with it, and the problem with zookeeper is that it adds quite a lot of operational overhead and problems. So the zookeeper coordination cluster takes care of cluster management. So it takes care of members joining the cluster, leaving the cluster. It takes care of in the failover case, so it first records data, so who is the current master, records the last transactions for each cluster member, so that in the election process you can use this information to elect a new master, and then of course atomically distribute this new election information to the cluster, so everyone is on the same page and there is not kind of two kings in a kingdom competing for the crown. We all saw like in Game of Thrones where it ended, right? So that's what zookeeper took care of us for. We didn't use any other functionality of zookeeper, actually. And it looked like this. So we had the green ones are the zookeeper nodes, which are kind of the tiny applications running somewhere. You have to have at least three because of the election process and the quorum. You can't have less than three. And then you have an arbitrary number of Neo4j nodes for the cluster itself. And everyone talks to everyone and communicates, so it's a lot of communication. And so some problems he had was the additional setup, so people didn't like that. They also asked us to add much more functionality to how when to start zookeeper, if it's possible to start a zookeeper cluster before the Neo4j cluster or after the Neo4j cluster or in parallel, because their Puppet and Chef scripts didn't like kind of a pre-described order of things, so it should be possible to for Neo4j cluster to wait until the zookeeper cluster actually up, even if you started it before that, and so on. So that was quite a pain. And we had also lots of problems with unreliable operations. So when there were networking issues or hiccups or GC, long-time GC operations on the Neo4j instance, then zookeeper quite quickly decided, yeah, now it's time to elect a new master. And if you have a kind of a very busy, heavy-loaded application, and then every minute it decides to elect a new master, and does this whole thing, then customers were not really happy about that. And also long-term stability, so we ran into some zookeeper issues we didn't, which affected kind of our ability to deliver. And something that was really critical as well was that if you started a zookeeper cluster, it's not possible to reconfigure it dynamically. So you can't kind of add new coordinator nodes or remove some. And that's especially in cloud setups. So Peter tried to get Neo4j HA run on Azure. Microsoft Azure, and they don't allow you to statically predefine anything. So you have to be able to cope with any machine failure. So if all your zookeeper machines fail, they will start new ones for you, but then they will have new IPs and new instances. And if you can't reconfigure the zookeeper cluster, the running zookeeper cluster, you have to shut down the whole HA cluster just because a coordinator failed or something like that. And all these things caused us quite a number of problems. And so we decided to, what you usually do, you roll your own, right? So because that's what you do. So we implemented multipaxes ourselves, looked at using really simple and testable code for that. And but this part only covers really the cluster management and the master election part of the HA cluster operations. So now it looks like that. It's simpler because each Neo4j cluster member is also part of the management infrastructure. And so you have as many Neo4j nodes as you have, or you have as many cluster management nodes as you have Neo4j nodes. And you can start and stop them at will, and it will automatically reconfigure itself and also heal on network partitions and so on, which is quite nice. So how does it work? What is Paxos? So who of you know Paxos, have read the paper and so on? Okay. It's quite an interesting read. There's a Paxos paper that's called Paxos Made Simple, I think, right? And that's quite nice. Even I could understand it, so that means quite a lot. It's about having a ability or a possibility of making decisions in a reliable way, even if the whole environment is unreliable. So you have a cluster of nodes, you have network in between, you have failing messages, you have failing machines, you have lost messages, reordered messages, so they come in out of order and so on. So all these factors, you have latency and so on. All these factors make a kind of deterministic consensus making. So I have something I have to decide on in a distributed manner because I have many participants. And then the decision has to be transported to all these members or participants, or even more, as well in an atomic manner. And that's with all the environment network problems around that. That's what Paxos is all about. So it was already started in 1980s or so to work on that, and there are lots of scientific papers and stuff like that. Something that the only kind of problem that Paxos has is it does not, in its kind of original implementation or paper, it does not guarantee progress. So it can kind of go on forever deciding. It's like parliament, right? It can also go on forever deciding and not deciding. So. So, but there are some changes to Paxos that will at least in most cases converge. So, and multi-Paxos is just that it can run multiple decision-making processes at the same time in the same state machines. Paxos is all about state machines. So we also implemented it as state machines. We, as Neo4j Java, we used Java enums, which are kind of constant object pattern implementations on the JVM, which is quite nice. So they can have, actually, they can implement interfaces, they can have methods, you can, within an enum, you can have polymorphism and so on. So it's a really nice model for that. And the state machines exchange messages. Messages consist of a type and a payload. So it's not so that the state machines don't have state, right? Enums are stateless, and also the message enums are also stateless, but you just keep the state in some arbitrary objects that are passed around with the state machine operation, which is the context of the state machine itself and the payload of the messages. And the actual state is the enum instance. So if I have an enum like, just show it in a quick minute there. If I have an enum like this, like acceptor state machine, then the start and the acceptor enum instances are actually two states of the state machine. And the state transition is handled in these handle methods, which get the message, the current context of the state machine, and also a also some way of sending messages. And what they do is in Java you can switch on enums, so you just do within the handle message you just switch on a message type and to have different logic of implementing the Paxos state machine. Something that we did is instead of using kind of the system time information or something like that, we using always timeouts for reliability, so we don't kind of synchronize or block something, it's just asynchronously. When we're waiting for something, we just set a timeout, and at the timeout a message will be sent, and we go into a state that is able to handle with these timeout messages. So either we moved out of the state because this thing we were waiting for already occurred, or we are in the state and the timeout message occurs, and then we know how to handle that. The implementation also handles failing messages by doing that, because then it will be requesting the things again, or just enter a recovery state. Something that was really important for testing was to decouple the actual implementation from the real systems time and network implementations. So you can, for instance, speed up time in testing, right? So you don't have to wait really the 30-second timeouts in your unit tests, or in these 5-second timeouts in your unit tests. And by decoupling the network, so abstracting the network, you could easily mark it and say, okay, I have this failing message pattern, or I have these lost messages, or I rerouted a message in the test, and so on, which is much easier if you abstract it away. Interestingly, the state machines are kind of on their own. There's kind of like a group of them that only talk to each other. It's like you know, us here just talking to us and not to the other people out there. And so how do they interact with the other, with the outside world? There's a kind of listener concept in there that actually listens to messages as well, and these listeners are the places where the interaction with the external world happens. So, for instance, when the master election result is broadcasted, then a listener will also receive this message and will tell the Neo4j HA infrastructure, you are now the master, you are now a slave, something like that. In Paxos itself, we have three roles. So we have the acceptor, the proposer, and the learner. And they interact with each other and use the cluster state. So who's currently a member? How many members of the cluster have we lost due to network partitioning or crashes or whatever? And that is determined by a heartbeat state machine, which is quite interesting, but I say something about that later, I think. So how does Paxos work? It works by, let's propose. So by the proposer getting a propose message from someone with a kind of a suggestion for something, like I suggest that Peter should become the master of this cluster. The proposer says, okay, I have this proposal. Now I ask the other parts of the cluster what they think about it. Right? So it sends out a prepare message to a number of acceptors. So this 2F plus 1 is kind of the number of acceptors you need to get progress. If you just take N acceptors for getting making a decision, then, or just F acceptors for making a decision, then it's probable that you don't make progress. But if you always take 2F plus 1, so always an odd number, larger than 3 or 3 or more, then you will make progress in the end. And so you send out a prepare message to all the acceptors, and of course set a timeout at the same time, because you expect that some of them won't answer, so the messages will come out of order back and so on. So the acceptor itself looks at the value that comes with the prepare message, and it says, okay, yeah, I agree, my value matches with that, so I promise if in the future you come along with a accept message that carries the same value, I promise that I will accept this message. It's like a two-phase commit a bit, right? Or if it doesn't match the value that it already has stored, then it sends a reject message. Then the proposer goes ahead again. Okay, he said, okay, I collected all these promises, so I now send out accept messages, which is kind of the second phase of like a two-phase commit. And if the accept payload matches my promise that I made before, which I stored here, then I send back an accepted message. Otherwise, I send a rejected message. So and the proposer then checks all the responses it collects. It counts them, and if it reaches the quorum, so the kind of the majority of the cluster members agree on a certain value, then it says, okay, we have to reach a decision. The timeouts will be canceled, and then the next step is to actually propagate this decision to all the members of the cluster that kind of register themselves as learners. We are interested in this information that the thing will be here. Yeah. So on the learn message, a learner receives a learn message, but these might be out of order. So as I said, multi-paxes can handle arbitrary number of parallel decision-making processes, but they're all numbered, so they have like a logical order, but it must or it's possible that they don't arrive in order. So it might be that the kind of first decision-making process arrives after the fifth, but it's kind of logically dependent. So you actually have to wait until the first has arrived to kind of take the other four that you already have and process them in a batch or in a row. So it does the kind of checking if it's in the correct order. If the value that I, or the decision that I got is in the right order, I can deliver all valid things via atomic broadcasts out there. But if I miss a value, so I have a list and there's a hole in the list, then I have to get this value somewhere, right? At the beginning, I just wait a while because it's just possible that the message has been delayed. 10? Okay, cool. I just wait a while because it's possible that the message could have been delayed. But if the timeout comes in and the message has not arrived yet, then I send out learn requests. So I would ask other cluster members if they, hi, do you actually know about this new thing on the blog that we should know about? And they say, yeah, I have the value, and send it back, or they don't know. And this kind of can repeat indefinitely. So it's this will run forever if the messages don't appear. So it does not kind of stop somewhere because it's trying to stay at a consistent state. That's how it works. And how is it implemented? So it's implemented in these enums that I already showed. So these are the state machines, the enums, which have states like start and acceptor. The handle message does the transition. It gets the context, so the state machine mutable state, to say so. It gets the message, which consists out of a payload and a message type, and a target for getting outgoing messages. So what it does, it switches on the message type, which might be, for instance, for the acceptor message, it might be the message type might be join. And then within the switch is the actual logic that is kind of implemented in the transition from one state to the other. So the transition from the start state to the acceptor state is, or the transition from the start state that happens with the join message is implemented in this place. And in this case here, it just returns a new state, which is acceptor, which is this state over here. If the message was not handled, or if it requires no state change, then it just returns itself again. So it was kind of, okay, I processed this message, or I ignored the message, and I'd stay in my state. And here you see some of the action that's possible. Right. Something that's quite interesting is for the heartbeat. So you have to have a heartbeat in the system. Of course, you can pull everyone for, are you alive, are you alive, are you alive? But that's quite a lot of waste on the network level. So what we do is actively send out heartbeat messages. But we only have to send out heartbeat messages if no other messages from that host arrived within a certain time period. So if it already sent us some other message, we don't have, or if it already sent some other message, we don't have to send out heartbeat messages. And if the other members already received messages, they can kind of cancel their heartbeat timeout to the, or set their heartbeat timeout to the next iteration. And so you save quite a lot of message parsing just for the cluster liveness information. For the master election process itself, for the Neo4j part of the master election, so all cluster members minus the failed ones, so all still living ones, have to agree. So it's a total vote, so everyone has to agree on the new thing. But the Paxos atomic broadcast needs a quorum of the total cluster members, including the failed. So if you have a cluster that has like 10 nodes or 10 members, and half of them have failed, it's very probable that you don't get a master elected because the Paxos atomic broadcast protocol itself needs a quorum, so at least 6 to agree on that thing. And then you might run without a master, which is quite interesting. So I already said that. Unit test, I didn't have an example here, but I can show that. So Peter did a nice screencast on how to set it up, which is kind of just starting a shell script. And configuring the class is now also much easier. So the original config, the zookeeper config, was you had to configure the whole zookeeper cluster with all its information. And then each cluster member has also to be configured with machine IDs and its also all the zookeepers and then the zookeeper had his own data store somewhere, and there was lots of moving parts involved, and now it's just, you know, like, these are the three nodes that are there. And for instance, for QA testing and so on, we also have a...
How do you handle dynamic IPs?
So you can handle dynamic IPs with different approaches. So one is broadcast, network broadcast. And the other thing is that you have a set of, for instance, DNS-handled configuration URLs that you can go to. So you have a... Yeah, but it will take some time anyway to change the master. So it's not so that if there's no master, the cluster will not be functional. Yeah. It just you can't write, so you can still read, and that's the most important thing for a cluster. So it's still available for read.
Because I'm thinking in a use case when you have
sorry, 5 minutes.
Yeah, I just quickly finish and then. So so we have a Rake script that just gets the Neo4j instances. And starts a cluster in a local machine, which is quite nice for testing and also for demonstrating that actually, if you change one value in one node, then it's also progressing to the other members. And also, if you kill it, then the other members will elect a new master and so on. So if I go to... So we have this server here, and in the server info we see in high availability this one is alive, this one is available, the last committed transaction ID is 4, and it's the master of the cluster. And if we have the other one, which is the 7.5, I think, right, so it's also alive and also available, transaction ID is also 4, and the role is a slave. So if I kill the master, let's do that. So it should actually go away, right? And then sometime later, the second node became the master in the cluster. So actually, it's also the case with Paxos. Usually, you get a happy pass, which doesn't involve timeouts, which doesn't involve resends and lost messages and so on. So it's really fast. But in the case that you have really network problems, that the network is unreliable and so, you don't want to rely on the happy pass, especially if you have very, very impressive customers that rely on your stuff, then you don't want to be kind of just on the happy path, because that doesn't work. So that's about it from my side, I think. And
so we have time for one very fast question. The next one will have the next we have
Do
to
have
be offline.
Examples of really disgusting filthy paths.
We have in the tests, we have examples of filthy paths.
So the
question was if you have examples of filthy paths. So filthy paths is something that's really nasty. Is you send a message to someone, it just goes away. So it was just alive. You send a message to him, expecting, of course, that it returns, and it goes away. Or in the middle of the master election, you get another network split or something like that. So these things happen, and you don't want them to happen. So we have, for instance, at Adobe, they have a worldwide cluster of Neo4j instances. So they have in Amazon data centers in the US, in Europe, and in Asia cluster running, and which has latencies across the globe, which is really ugly. And this is, for instance, a good example of what you should be able to handle there. Cool.
Okay, thank you very much. And we see in half an hour.